In this video lecture, we'll briefly go over how to call or use a method from some other code. Okay, let's get started. To use a method in some other external application code simply means providing that method with all of the input data it's expecting to receive. You might see this referred to as calling a method, invoking a method, making a method call, or maybe in some other terms. Relax, it's all just different ways of saying the same thing. When we call a method, it's important that we adhere to its interface exactly. That means we need to provide it with the number of inputs it's expecting, in the order it's expecting them, and with the data types it's expecting. However, the names of the variables we provide to the method do not have to match the names in the interface. This is because methods are called by value, which means that we are providing copies of the input values, leaving the original values unchanged. The way we call a method differs slightly depending on whether we call it from inside or outside its class. If we are calling a method from within the class, we can simply make a direct method call. If we are calling a method from outside the class, we have to do this in the context of some other object using dot notation. We'll look at some examples of this shortly. When we provide the inputs to a method, what we need to give it is any valid expression that meets each specified data type. These could be variables, literals, constants, other method calls, or any Java expression involving any of these. Let's take a look at some examples on the next slide. After we've done that, if you need to see it again, please take a moment to pause this video and view the short code walkthrough video for methodexamples.java and methodexamplesclient.java. Open up these files in JGrasp so you can follow along. You'll find these examples in the example source code module on Canvas. Come back to this video when you are finished. Here are a bunch of examples of calling methods from Java. The big difference between the left side and the right side is where the method is located. If it's internal to the same class, you can simply call the method by name, as shown here on the left. If the method is external to the class as part of some reusable component, we first have to declare an object of that type and then call the method using dot notation in the context of that object. Otherwise, it's pretty much the same between left and right. So let's say that we have a method called addTwoNumbers, and let's say that it accepts two int inputs, adds them up, and returns an int result. As long as the method is provided with two integers, it doesn't care how those get provided to it. So we can provide it two hard-coded literals, two variables of integer type, an expression that evaluates or rolls up into a single integer. Any one of those will work. Next, notice that these are two identical statements. If this method addTwoNumbers returns an int value, this entire expression rolls up into one single int value. So we can replace an int that's a literal like this with an int that's the result of some method call. Finally, if we're calling a void method, notice that nothing is returned to any left-hand side variable, so we simply call the method by name. Also, if the method furthermore takes no inputs, the parentheses are still there, but they're empty. And here's another method which takes two string inputs, but returns no value. These are both void methods. There are four basic flows of control in programming. These refer to the general path of execution in any program. We've already seen lots of examples of sequential execution, in which instructions are executed one after another. We'll take a look at selection and looping control flows later in the semester. For now, let's focus on the flow of execution inherent in a method call. When a method call is encountered, the program jumps to that method in memory, and it is evaluated fully. At the end of a method, a resulting value may or may not be returned by the method. The flow of control then jumps back to the point in which the original method was encountered. As we've already seen to a small extent, the flow of control through a program is very nicely demonstrated by using a debugger, so that we can single step through the path of execution. Again, I strongly encourage you to get comfortable with the JGrasp debugger for this purpose. You can take a look at some of the prior code walkthroughs for demonstration of how to do this. Finally, Here we see a flowchart for the flow of control which takes place upon a method call. As we can see, our client program is proceeding along in sequential execution when it encounters a method call. At that point, execution jumps to some other place in memory, where the statements of the method are themselves executed sequentially. When execution reaches the end of the method, any return value is sent back to the point of the original method call in the client program, and the execution path resumes in the client program. Okay, and with that, we end this discussion on method usage.